this little mark here catches my eye that something is different, which means, okay, the tail all of a sudden is showing up way out here.
Long tail weasel, short tail weasel. This is actually in a possibility size range of mink.
George Leoniak is about to be tested on his tracking skills, along with 12 other trackers. He is practicing at his home in Vermont.
I gotta know the difference between a red and a gray squirrel, and flying squirrels, and chipmunks, and rats, and they can all almost be about the same size. So you don't ever walk past a squirrel track again.
Answer is inside that circle. Everything you need to answer the question. But that does not mean that you cannot go beyond the circle. You can go wherever you like.
Leading this evaluation is senior tracker Mark Elbroch. He has written numerous books on natural history and works as a wildlife consultant for biological studies.
Asymmetry is the really big giveaway, and that it is longer than it is wide.
This weekend's evaluation is in Southern California.
Cool. I don't know. I'm nervous, but at the same time, it'll be what it'll be.
What you are allowed to bring to a station, a flashlight, and yourself, and that's all.
The trackers head off for their first round of questions. Over the next 2 days, they will be asked anything from animal identification to animal behavior.
And right, we want to know who made this and which foot it is.
Is a possum. It's the left side. It's the left side of the body.
The questions are never predetermined because they are provided to us by our environments. It's very much about what we all can agree we see and agreeing on what we see and interpreting it in whatever fashion we might have to.
So that's the hind foot, and it's often when it's walking set behind the front foot. So you have a hind and a front going in this direction. Everyone see that? Which toe? If we can't convince you of an answer, like you say, that's a black bear, and we can't come up with reasons on the ground to show you that it's not a black bear, that it's a human, then we'll throw out the question.
We function with visual cues all the time. I mean, even if you think about icons, like on a DVD player, that's a visual symbol that has this meaning for me. And now I go to a CD player and it's the same visual cue and I know what it means. And I'm like, oh, push that button to skip.
Some of the trackers are here to hone their skills in wildlife ecology or biology, but Shankar is an electrical engineer by day and a tracker by other days.
But then there's something there which is not the way this would have been structured if it was just rain on this landscape. And I see that that's most likely a footprint or a shoe print or something like that out there.
And then you go closer and you see how the compression goes. And, so you're learning to train your mind to see disturbances on top of the underlying substrate.
Mark's hope is that the evaluation will allow tracking to become a standard tool in wildlife studies. In 2006, he worked with trackers Jonah and C.L. Evans to test the evaluation on a group of biologists who were conducting a study on otters for the Texas Parks and Wildlife Department. Heidi Bailey was one of those biologists.
They just wanted to make sure that if we're taking the time to do the study, that they want to be absolutely sure that we got it correct. There was concern that maybe when the biologists would head out under bridges to look for otter signs, that we might not be able to distinguish it from, say, raccoons or bobcats or things like that.
And what they were wondering is whether their data set from all those years was a credible source to analyze, and how would they analyze it, to determine whether or not river otter populations had been going up and down or declining or inclining over the course of those years.
And what did they find? The data wasn't useful.
The data was not something useful.
What the biologists were calling otter sign wasn't always otter sign. Sometimes it was a raccoon, sometimes it was a mink. They needed to brush up on their tracking skills. The department in Texas now uses the evaluation to train their biologists.
Out of nearly 10 years with Parks and Wildlife, it's by far the best training that I've had. And not only that, the most enjoyable as well.
And as for the otter study?
The evaluation provided a wonderful training so that the data they collect in the future might be more useful.
Have you ever gotten one of those emails where the whole email is like written with the first letter and the last letter intact, but they've scrambled all the words, all the letters in between? I was thinking about that, and it's like, I think it's the same thing with like tracking. Like when you get those clear words, so to speak, clear raccoon tracks or beaver tracks, for example, whatever it is, and then you kind of get it burned into your mind, and then it's almost like you find those words where the letters on the end are the same, but it's scrambled in between the obscure tracks. But you read it immediately without thinking about it. You're like, oh, that's a raccoon.
After each round of questions, trackers explain what they think they see.
And I was just looking at the size of this, of the heel pad, being really beefy, very large, also kicked off at an angle compared to the toes, just a tad.
You mean bobcat?
No, I meant house cat, large house cat. And then I decided it was a bobcat.
Okay.
So.
And why did you say that? Because of this beefy
like
pad.
Very beefy heel pad, also the heel pad being angled.
So here's a house cat right here. The outer toes. See how high they are? And if you look in this one, see these ones are almost tucked right behind these. And that's the best indicator for me, or the best handle to tell between a house cat, a big house cat, and a small bobcat. And that the pad itself is very low bait versus the house cat, which is not quite as discreetly lobed or as deeply lobed, you might say. So we feel all right about that?
The biggest out of all.
Yep.
He tends to show up.
Some of these trackers have been honing their skills for years. And for some of them, the evaluation will open up doors for employment. For others, it's simply a way to challenge themselves or to look at the world differently.
The separation between, I mean, I don't know the wood rats too well, but they seem like wood rats.
This one's pretty fresh.
Nate Kempton has used his skills to work for the FBI.
This one's a couple days or a day.
When I first started working with the FBI, they hired me to teach them how to backtrack human remains. And what is happening is they'll find, somebody will report a femur, and they'll bring the FBI out, and the FBI will look at it, and they'll say, okay, that's a human femur. The only problem is that they need to recover more of the body, more of the bones, in order to pull DNA.
It's like any professional sport or professional thing. It's like you look at professional baseball players or professional basketball players, and there's a certain degree of instinct that has to come into play for them to play at that level. To really get good at playing at that level, they have to touch that place, that flow, and get good enough at it to where they can repeat it, you know, on a job level to be a professional.
The San Diego tracking team has used their skills to show that there's a need for wildlife corridors where roads and human development have limited the natural ranges of animals. These corridors allow wildlife to use long stretches of land without having to cross dangerous roads or highways.
And to be able to say that a species is or is not present on the landscape is incredibly valuable. From a research standpoint, from an educational standpoint, from a relationship standpoint of feeling like you are part of that ecosystem.
Owl barf bar, yeah. Yeah.
Could you get
a great horn?
Yeah, it's pretty large.
Look at that. Look at the size of the bone.
Now he's going to ask us the femur or whatever part of that is.
Look at dick
bear. Yeah.
What it reveals, and it revealed it for me, I've gone being evaluated, it's just incredible, the emotional roller coaster of it, the tension, the fear, the worrying I won't do well, also just how the mind works and what I'm afraid of and how my ego is invested in my tracking skills, as well as what I see on the ground and how I am able to make that just about anything I want. Folks, over and over again, they are amazed that the evaluation reveals to them how they think.
Many trackers have learned to think in terms of size comparisons. Some similar species can be told apart by the size of their tracks. But rulers are not allowed on the evaluation. Trackers must come up with their own tricks.
That's about the size of a pocket mouse, his track.
The mark on your thumb.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And a toey is to there.
But you know, you learn things if you measure long enough, like from the end of my finger to that mole right there, it's 4 inches exactly.
Well, this is a little under an inch, but it's close enough to where I use these for rough measurements. Each little knuckle is about an inch.
This one and this one.
An inch, exactly.
Exactly an inch.
This stuff, the quicker it starts to come to us. It's just like our eyes begin to calibrate, and things that were so foreign before, they just start categorizing into files. Like
one category of discussion is the canine track.
Well, who thinks it's a gray fox after all our discussion? Who thinks it's a domestic dog? And who thinks it's a coyote? And then there's a bunch of folks who are undecided, apparently.
To have a systematic way of going about it, in not only learning your tracks and sign, but learning about the species and the relationships. And the taxonomic system that was developed by Linnaeus helps group animals into clusters. So if they go to new regions, they can start to look for similarities in the tracks, because a lot of families have similar types of tracks.
See that one? Right there. Yep, see that? That one, when I could really see the front foot by itself, almost by itself, how it's kind of, the H is very clear where the two rear toes of the are right in that H space. That's a common clue that I tend to look for sometimes for a gray fox, is that understepping direct register.
I too believe it's a gray fox.
The evaluation began in South Africa. It was developed by Louis Liebenberg as a way to validate the knowledge of traditional African trackers. Many of those trackers could not read or write, but they had great skills. The evaluation allowed them a formal certification process to prove their knowledge to potential employers.
Traditionally, the tracker would be from one of the communities where there's no formal schooling, or was, you know, 30, 40, 50 years ago.
Adriaan Louw runs a company in South Africa called Eagle's Wing Bush Skills. He also leads tracker certification programs.
A lot of the people with a traditional skill of tracker had never been through formal schooling. And therefore, because they couldn't read and write, they'd never received anything in terms of paper for what they can do. And Louis Liebenberg realized that that is a serious vacuum in terms of recognition of traditional skills.
South African trackers who have this certification are now highly coveted by employers. Mark Elbroch went to Africa, learned the system, got evaluated as a tracker in the African ecosystem, and then brought it back to the U.S. His hope is that the evaluation will allow tracking to take a more prominent role in scientific data collection and provide a standardized certification process for trackers of all backgrounds.
We're trying to get away from educational background as a standard for your skill level and moving toward the experience. Hopefully, we're expanding the pool of trackers because people may climb out of the woodwork who are hunters, trappers, whatever, who just have this background of experience and may be really, really good trackers.
But tracking isn't only about the tracks on the ground.
And I also use it as a vehicle to facilitate change in people. The ecotourism industry had protected a lot of private land in South Africa, which otherwise would have been taken up for cattle ranching or real estate development. The moment you deal with ecology or geography or trees or whatever, there's always somebody who sort of loses interest until you show him a footprint. And you start following the footprint, then forever there will be interest.
Having worked on both continents, Adriaan has noticed differences in the ways various cultures learn and see.
Because of our Western schooling, we read left to right, top to bottom. And the moment you look in the bush, the moment you walk through the woods, and you start scanning, and your eyes go left to right, you look in one plane. It's a muscle memory sitting somewhere in your head. And your eyes don't focus on anything else. You focus on the first thing you see, and that's the focus depth that you maintain right through. Untrain that by starting to scan right to left. Then your eyes bounce in between the trees and the brush. Different depths, different levels. And scan far, mid-range close, far mid-range close, far mid-range close. So as you go along, every time you get to a point, you'd already seen it three times.
One of the trackers from this evaluation, Nate Kempton, is also partaking in the trailing portion of the evaluation, in which the goal is to track one animal until you catch up to it. Here, he is trailing a deer.
Regardless of whether or not we catch this animal, I'd like to move like we could, in the sense that I will, if you're crashing through bushes and making tons of noise, that's a detriment to the trailing experience, and that's something that you are scored on. We're not expecting you to stalk at, you know, one step per second through here. We would never even have a chance of seeing the animal, so that's not the goal either. But, you know, moving at a good pace, but minimizing your noise. The way we communicate is in whispers, through gestures, any way you can get the message across. Getting your focus up is you're checking like this rather than, you know, the second I'm like this, I don't see anything.
Adriaan has noticed that people who have had Western schooling are able to learn tracks and sign through pictures and words in books, but not all cultures are used to learning that way.
The non-Western schooled black person would quite often have to see the animal making the track before he knows what it is. But overall, they get it all together, both track and sign and trailing, much faster than the Western schooled individual. And it's simple because we've got that mindset of we have to be systematic. I mean, that's why we read a book from the front to the back. We need to work hard at untraining ourselves from the systematic thing to become speculative and intuitive eventually.
This is
this is what happened. Right there, I had him at a run, and then I lost him right there.
To me, I wonder if it's one of the things that is related to what it means to be fundamentally human. And I think that there very likely was a time that tracking played a role in how we think, how we utilize language, and how we move on the landscape.
It's the second and final day of the evaluation. By the end, the trackers will have been asked over 100 questions.
My snowshoe tracks from yesterday, and when I came out here yesterday about 2 o'clock and sat right over there, there was no mink trail at this point, and now the mink tracks are inside my tracks and going in that direction. So now we know that it's about 2 o'clock today. These tracks were made within 24 hours.
The animal's a coyote. The gate was a trot. And there was a comparison between the fresher track belonged to the coyote, between the coyote and the human.
Thinking about how an animal was moving can tell you about its behavior. Was it running? Walking? Where did it stop? And why?
Pretty much the patterns on the ground,
yeah.
But I don't really have all the mechanics put together of how those patterns are made. And once you start understanding the mechanics, you can kind of like become the animal and sort of see it, the world through its eyes, at least perceptually a little bit, and understand where they're coming from. You know, sometimes it's easy to get locked in seeing everything from the human point of view.
Employed at the art institution, designer minds for pretty pens, inspired to make your contribution, cause life ain't fun if you don't take a chance. Time flies when you work away the day one, two. Emerge from your shell in arabesque instead of swimming in piles miles high upon the desk. So let's strip off our clothes and run through the woods, tearing the fabric apart, cause we're all just animals at heart.
There are very real ways to move into interpretation in the sense of what is that animal doing there? How is it moving? What was it doing in that moment? When was it moving through? I mean, there are so many questions that can go through your mind. How is it interacting with other wildlife there? Was it feeding? Was it foraging? Was it nervous? Was it... Not only do you know it's a bobcat now, but you know how it's moving. And then you think, well, why is it moving that way if it's not in its usual sort of rhythm that it usually just cruises around the landscape? So why did it change? Because there's a reason. And that is, of course, a doorway into behavior. To me, that's when tracking really takes on a new life. And that's one of the reasons that I really got into gaits.
The best way I could do it is saying that the front feet land like so. Picture the whole body in the air, my whole body in the air like so. The front feet land, the rear feet are still in the air. Now the rear feet are coming into the same spots that just left the fronts. And as I land with my rear feet in there, which I won't attempt to do, this is the part that gets hard, the rear feet land in these spots as the fronts move out. So picture the rear's coming in, the front's leaving, and then the rear's push off, and now the animal's back like this again, and then...
Embodying the sweet and the tart, to tear the social fabric apart.
Mark wraps up the trailing part of the evaluation with Nate. Nate didn't catch up to the deer this time, but they discuss his score.
Again, I'm trying not to judge you on your first 20, 25, 30 minutes because I really felt like we were seeing someone different.
Mm-hmm.
Afterwards, I felt like you did recognize them. At first, I think you stumbled with them.
When trailing, trackers are scored on everything from the pace they keep to the amount of noise they make to whether they disturb other animals in the area to their awareness of wind direction.
Your backpack was a constant source of noise, so that's just something to consider for the future. Use of cover to approach animal and exit route, we didn't get a chance to do that. Appropriate proximity to animal, we didn't get a chance to do that. But overall, I thought you did very well as far as maintaining your head up once you fell into your rhythm. So I would give you, if we were to put a number, I would say like 9.
Okay.
The trackers have just a few more questions before the evaluation is over and they receive their scores.
Question would be, what animal made this track? And the second line is here. And the second question would be, what animal made this track here?
And a bonus question for those who are playing is these two right here. You see the little teeny things?
The group waits while Mark calculates the scores.
I'm going to just jump right into it. For those who haven't experienced this part before, I follow in the African tradition, and the African tradition is to talk about your tracking skills as separate from you. And, they're very open about where they are in the journey. They realize that this is something you learn. No one's born a tracker. No one's expected to be an expert tracker, and that all of us are on that journey of learning. So today, when I looked at the scores, Casey McFarland had 2 wrong, and he had 4 bonuses, which erased one of those wrongs. So I took Casey on a little walk, and I gave him 10 questions.
I just got a bunch of bonus questions because I was one away.
Everything from rusty blackbird to the faintest cottontail tracks I could find.
Mark calls it running the gauntlet when a tracker is so close to 100% that the evaluator asks him 10 of the most difficult questions he can find in order to erase the one missed point.
Deer pellet that somehow got sprayed into the middle of nowhere.
Pocket gopher and then deer scat and
to snipe, faint, and dried out.
Cottontail scat and then flycatcher scat all over this post.
Flycatcher scat.
It was brutal.
I just threw him a whole bunch of curveballs, and he hit every one of them. And so it was with the most pleasure that I give Casey McFarland 100%. George Leoniak has silently been becoming one of the best track and sign interpreters in the country, and I've known that for years. And I'm just so happy to be able to say it in front of people. So, I've been looking forward to this day since I became an evaluator, is to give out the first 100%. And the next step is the full senior tracker, which will be 100% on trailing and the spore ID. So it is an opportunity, I think, for them to gain the recognition to become the teachers in their communities, potentially, to gain employment, maybe just to pat themselves on the back that they've come a long way.
Yes, I did not expect it at all. I thought I was doing quite poorly.
Definitely. I'm going to hit some other evals in other parts of the United States and just keep working on it.
I'm probably the first tracker from India to get the tracking sign.
You know, when you go back and you look at the ones that you got wrong, then when you see how you came to the conclusion that you did, then you're able to track your thinking process and you start to see that. And the reason I thought that is because that's how I see the world. It's like relearning an old language, you know, ideographic symbols on the ground. It's beautiful.
Tacos and rice and beans, and I happen to notice a rodent species, very small, looks like a mouse, running through my beans prior to it coming out to me, and I want a refund. House mouse, right rear, female, I think.